From theory to practice, welcome to the show today. Welcome to the program this afternoon. Welcome to the Monday edition of what it is that we are trying to do. We are post-Super Bowl, but pre-CPI. So we're in kind of that weird limbo phase of excitement where we're not really sure what to do. So we're going to try to figure out what that is together for the next 40 or 42 minutes. So if you're over on Tasty, the Tasty Network, forget about Tasty, hop on over to YouTube, join the discussion. You can interact with me. You can interact with fellow individuals inside of the Tasty sphere of the world, and it will be a good time had by all. So drop in your questions in the chat box. I will try to get to as many of them as I can. So while you guys are getting situated and you're getting all set up and all those different things, I want to talk about what's going on in my portfolio for a couple of minutes. And then let's also talk about the markets for a couple of minutes. And then I have a strategy that I want to put on for CPI, which is basically like the, you know, economy-wide earnings. I want to put this guy on today in IWM. We're going to use a fun little expected move butterfly. So, all right. So what I want to do first, if you look at the, and I've been sick for about 5 weeks straight, so still sick, still powering through and just trying to get it done. If you take a look at the portfolio, the first thing I want to draw everyone's attention to, because it doesn't happen that often, is we have a pair of winners in the portfolio. So if you look a little bit more closely at what might be happening, again, you got to look closely. And you got to do it quickly because it might disappear here any second. If you look at our EWZ trade, you can see that we put this trade on for $1.65. It's currently marking at 73 cents. So we have a nice little win right there. Also, IBM, we put that trade on for $2.50. It's currently marking at 91 cents. A nice little winner there too. So I think I want to take both these trades off. I don't see any reason to continue to hold risk on any regular day of the market, let alone a CPI day, let alone right before, you know, the most important CPI print of our lifetimes until next month. So let's go ahead and let's take off EWZ and IBM. You can see these are both short strangles that we had on. Let's see, we did EWZ. When do we do EWZ? So we did this guy back on, January 13th. We did. It wasn't supposed to be an iron condor. That was a mistake that I made. So it was supposed to be a short strangle. So that's why you see that little adjustment right there. And so we did this on January 13th. So it's been, 1 month exactly. So 1 month to the day was when we put this trade on, and we never really took any heat. If I'm not mistaken, we were not tested on either side, or maybe we were tested a little bit. Hold on. Were we tested on the bottom side a little bit? Let me look into this just quickly for a hot second. If I look at, we got 27 and 32 are the two strikes. If I bring up a chart of EWZ from January 13th, so that's going to be like here. Yeah, down here. Okay, no, we were never tested on the bottom side. You can see the 27 marker is like right there. And I mean, I'm no math genius. I'm no chart genius, but it looks like there's a little bit of space right there. But that looks like a little bit, I don't know if that's a gap down or a gap up or a gap sideways, but there's some kind of gap happening right there. So we were never tested on the downside. And so, so this was a pretty easy trade for all intents and purposes, even intensive purposes for you people out there. And so EWZ, easy, easy, lemon breezy. So that's EWZ. Let's look at IWM here really quick. So similar thing, I think. We did this for earnings, though. We did this for IBM earnings, which was January 24th. So that was a little bit more recent than the EWZ trade that we did. But still, I don't think we've taken any heat on this trade. I think when we first put it on, IBM was pretty nicely centered between the two strikes. I think IBM was maybe like in the low 140s, like 140, 141, 142 or thereabouts. And then we had a little down move from earnings, but we never got tested on the strikes, I believe. So let's go into the chart here for IBM. Yeah, I mean, you can see it right here. I don't even need to know where I got in the trade. You know, we're at the 130 strike. That's right down there. And once again, you know, I'm no chart expert. There's no Tim Knight on the program here today. But that's a gap if I've ever seen one. That's a little space if I've ever seen one. And so I see a couple of abandoned babies in there, maybe some island reversals, still a little pin bar action up there. And so, so nothing to do at all on these trades. We were never tested. You know, again, I think these are two really good examples of, you know, exercising some patience, maybe tapping into the do nothing strategy from time to time, maybe not necessarily being hyper aggressive with your adjustments, you know, bringing the calls down when the stocks fall, even when your strikes are not tested. Because had you done that, you might not be in the same situation that we're in here today. Now, of course, you know, every gimme has a gotcha, every pro has a con, every give has a get for all my Kramer fans out there. So if the stocks would have kept falling, which I didn't know what was going to happen, and neither did anyone else, especially all of my Kramer fans out there, if the stock would have kept falling, then it would have been more beneficial to roll that call down more aggressively. But I kind of like the more laissez-faire approach to the strategic management side of the business. And so yes, that's IBM and EWZ. Let me take these guys off quickly. And then I see you guys are loading up your questions. That's good. Get all your questions in. Get as many in as you can. And then I'll try to get to as many as I can. Let me close out EWZ. And let me close out of IBM really quick. And I'll push these out on the follow page, of course, over at the Tasty Works. So let me go ahead and do this. All right. So we're out of EWZ for 75 cents. Let me go ahead and do IBM really quick too. And then I want to make sure I get this IWM. So we're getting out of IBM. We're going to get into IWM. So I'll try to keep those set, at least in my own head. And I want to make sure I get that out before I get into y'all's questions, because once we get into the questions, there's usually no turning back. So let me just do like 94. Yes, we got Phil for 93 cents there on the IBM closing order for the strangle. Both winners, both good trades. Pretty happy about that. I'll push both of those out on the follow page over at the Tasty Works. But just one quick comment about the overall market right now. Oh, man. I mean, I don't know, guys. I'm not really sure. I don't know what to believe anymore. I mean, last night, UFOs were bearish. Now UFOs are bullish. And so I don't really know, right? I mean, it's really interesting to see how the market prices in alien invasion. Right? How does the market price in alien invaders? I mean, you're seeing it happen right now. You got NQ up 200 points. You got the Dow up 3.5 unis. Right? It's like alien invasion. That's bullish. That's mega pint bullish. And so, yeah, man, pretty interesting stuff. Now, going into tomorrow's number, the CPI print, you know, is everybody positioning themselves to take advantage of a soft print? Is everybody positioning themselves to take advantage of, you know, a cool CPI number? That's what it appears would be the case, at least one of the driving forces right here and right now. And has there ever been a time when the investing public has been incorrect? Like, has there ever been a time when these pumps before the numbers have led to dumps after the numbers? I don't think so. Like, I'm pretty sure this is a 100% accuracy reading when it comes to what the market is telling us today based on what the market is going to do tomorrow. So obviously take that for what it's worth. There was a tremendous amount of internet sarcasm right there, just in case you're brand new to the program. So ESNQYM got Russell up 22 points. He's got notes up a couple ticks. I mean, when notes are up a couple ticks, you know that there must have been an alien invasion. Like, when you've got notes up a couple ticks along with everything else up, alien invaders reside among us. So ESNQ, excuse me, YM, all looking pretty strong. So, all right, so here's what I want to do. IWM. Now, we normally do expected move butterflies in individual stocks. We don't normally use these strategies in the indexes. But because we have this huge economic print tomorrow morning, excuse me, because we have this huge economic print tomorrow morning, then we can kind of use that economic print the same way that we would use an earnings release, like the same way that we would use, you know, just some earnings number like from a Chipotle or a Snowflake or whoever. So let's go ahead and let's go into IWM. I've got the strategy down that Amelia May has set for us, our assistant, our intern, the real trader on the program. She wants to go into the front week. Whew, it's a bold strategy, Cotton. See how it plays out for her. So she wants to do a 189, 182, 175 expected move butterfly. She's only going to pay 92 cents for it. So we're obviously playing the market to the downside. You can see we're a little stretched beyond the expected move here. So I'm a little down below the expected move. But this is basically going to be this is going to be my optimal window of price, right? Obviously, nailing the short strike would be the perfect scenario, but really anything between 189 and 182 would be really, really good. And so we're pushing a little bit below the expected move. That's going to lessen the cost of the expected move butterfly a little bit. Like you can see right here, I'll even show you guys before we get to the questions. If I were to raise my strikes up a little bit, so right now, if you look in the lower left-hand corner, you see I'm 175, 182, 189. If I move all those up a little bit to get a little bit closer to the action, if you will, you'll notice that the cost of the butterfly increases because that's going to be a higher probability play. Like you can see right here, the pop is 26%. This is how I have the strategy set up right now. Just really quickly, just for, you know, completeness purposes, let me highlight all of my strikes. If I move them down on the screen, now it gets a little janky because we've got that 182 and a half in there, but you can see 176, 82 and a half, 90. Debit went up, probability went up. Let me do it again. 77, 83, 91. Debit went up, probability went up. Again, it's a little jank. It's a lot jank, actually. $6 on one side, $8 on another side. So I'm not going to do this, but I just wanted to show you guys that when you get a little bit closer to the action, then you have to pay more for that because you have a higher probability outcome. And so, you know, probabilities aren't free. Like, you know, you always have to be willing to accept some kind of a gotcha that goes alongside the gimme that is a higher probability. So I'm going to go back to the strikes we had. And then I want to get to y'all's questions, man. So, all right. So here we go. 89, 82, 75. This is going to be the play for the CPI print tomorrow morning that everybody is going to be watching. I am absolutely going to be on pins and needles. Or I might still be sleeping, but either way, I'm going to figure out what happens tomorrow morning when the CPI print comes out, and we'll see what happens. You know, maybe there'll still be a stock market. Maybe there won't be. Maybe there'll still be a human race. Maybe there won't be. I mean, there's a lot of things up in the air right now. So if we go ahead and we buy 95 cents, we're filled for 95 cents. There you go. Let's get to some questions. Got lots of comments already coming in. This is good. I love it. You love it. Let's do it. Harold Montero says, Dr. Jim, it's your boy. What's up, Harold? Let's talk CPI, man. Let's do it. Powell mentioning the Fed may continue raising interest rates. That is what he has said, meaning they couldn't expect an uptick, sort of like extinguishing in, meaning they could expect an uptick, sort of like extinguishing an upcoming fire that hasn't happened yet. It's sort of like that. If CPI continues to decrease, why the hawkish wording? Bad news that that isn't coming into effect now. Yeah, you know, so I think that a couple of things. So number one, let's say, what is the consensus tomorrow? Is it 6.5? I think the consensus right now is 6.5. I'm not sure. I mean, there's different banks that come out with different numbers, but I think the consensus across most of the analyst banks, you know, prognosticators, whatever, is 6.5. So if it's 6.5, then if it comes in at 6.3, right, that would probably be deemed a very positive outcome by the market, which could lead to a rally. It could lead to a sell-off. I mean, who knows what's going to happen. But if it comes in underneath 6.5, that's going to be positively interpreted from an economic condition standpoint. It still, however, means that inflation is still increasing at an annualized rate of 6.3%, if that's what it comes in at. So that's good news. That means that we're moving in the right direction. Don't get me wrong. But it still means that we have a long way to go to get to the Fed target of whatever that target is. I feel like they change it every quarter or two nowadays. It used to be 2%. Now maybe it's 3%. Maybe it's 3.5%. Whatever. It's 2%. It's 3%. It's some number of basis points between the two. I don't know. We're still pretty far away from where they want that number to live, right? So given that, I think Powell is just reminding everyone that he is still going to aggressively attack the interest rate problem. He's still going to aggressively attack, you know, the interest rate issue. And so, Ryan, did I lose my video? Hang on a second.
That looks like it dropped.
Ryan, did I lose my video? Hold on a second, guys.
That looks like it dropped.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, it's still on my end. Oh, there we go. Okay, we're back. There we go. Cool. Thank you. Okay. Awesome. So we got our video back. So there you go. So you guys don't have the audio only version, but yeah. So I think he's just trying to make everybody know, make everybody realize that he's serious about this. And I got to give him some credit. I mean, he's been pretty consistent. He's been pretty consistent from the beginning in that, you know, this has been his primary mandate. And so it's going to be interesting to see if he can play that out and see that through to the end. I think that's what he's trying to do to everybody, to let them know that, you know, he's going to take this very seriously. He's not going to give up until the job is done. And so I really think that's what it is, Harold. And so I just, you know, people talking about QE, people talking about stuff like, you know, yeah, just reversing course and pivots and all this stuff. I think that's crazy talk. I think we're a long, long way away from that. And so I don't know, man, we'll have to wait and see. But so Theta Trader says, Dr. Jim, last week with the big drop on Google, I was setting up a put ratio on the close when suddenly Bob Nosnoff, that must be Bob Nosnoff's cousin, did the same trade on air. Ooh, that'll never, never leave you feeling the warm and fuzzies. Never. If you do a trade and you think you've got it figured out, like you think, man, I feel pretty good about this trade. And then you log into like a last call or, you know, even a first call or whatever, and you see a Bob Nosnoff put on the exact same trade, that basically guarantees that you're going to start taking heat. Like that basically guarantees that you're going to be in some hot water really, really quickly. So, so it's a Theta Trader. I totally understand why you feel the way that you feel. Now I question everything. How concerned should I be? Very. You should be very concerned. And so I'm not sure what that means. I think maybe you need to start buying a couple calls and buying a couple puts just to cleanse your palate, just to kind of bring things back to baseline and get that pH level restored. And so hopefully that that helps you a little bit. But general macro environment question. Ah, here we go. Do you follow Benjamin Graham? Man, Benjamin Graham. Well, let me read the rest of your question. This market has reminded me of his favorite quote. Paraphrasing, short-term voting machine, long-term weighing machine. I always thought that was a Buffett quote. But I think Buffett is a Graham. He's a Graham guy. And so he probably ripped it off from Graham. And so I've heard that same quote. And so Benjamin Graham, did he write Capital Assets? I think he wrote the Intelligent Investor, if I'm not mistaken. And then maybe he also wrote the Five Pillars of Investing or something like that. And so I've read those two books. I read them a long time ago, 20, 25 years ago. And I think from like a long-term like valuation standpoint where, you know, you're just thinking about, you know, company valuations, you're thinking about, you know, long-term financial health of the company, you're thinking about cash flow prospects, you're thinking about, you know, discounting cash flow mechanisms and things like that. I think it can be incredibly valuable. I think his take on the markets is incredibly valuable if you have a very, very long-term view. I actually am of the mind that, you know, in like a 45-day time horizon, I have a really hard time thinking that the macro environment is going to help you really at all. I really think it's very difficult for the macro environment to pair up with a, you know, 30-day time horizon, 45-day time horizon, whatever. But I reserve the right to change my mind. I reserve the right to change my mind as new information comes in, as I think about things more, as I, you know, gather more insights or whatever. But right now, I have a hard time matching those things up together. However, going out to like, you know, probably beyond 6 months, but like a year, 2 years, 5 years, 10 years. I think the macro landscape is very important. I think the macro landscape is important. I think the micro landscape at the company level is very important. And so like getting to the quote that you put down there, it's a short-term voting machine. It's a long-term weighing machine. I think that's absolutely correct. I think it's absolutely correct from the standpoint that, you know, in the short term, there's going to be so many different things that are moving the markets. This is why it's so, like CPI is a great example, right? Even if you knew the CPI number beforehand, I don't know if you could make money off of that. I really don't. Now, if it's something crazy, like if the consensus is 6.5 and this thing's coming in at 5.8, okay, yeah, you could probably make a few shekels if you knew that beforehand. Or, you know, the consensus is 6.5 and it's going to print 7.5. Like, yeah, that's probably going to be a sell-off. Like, I think we can all agree that the markets are not going to go higher in that situation. But I do think that under normal circumstances and within some range of, you know, realistic outcomes, it's very difficult to make money knowing the numbers beforehand. I absolutely agree. And so that gets into this whole short-term voting machine type of situation where you just don't know, you know, how the votes are going to be cast. You just don't know, like, how the votes are going to, you know, what's going to be on the ballots. You don't know how people are going to react. You don't know how people are going to, you know, cast their ballots. And so I agree. Whereas in the long term, it being a weighing machine, you know, kind of weighing profits and losses, kind of weighing, you know, revenues and expenses, kind of weighing, you know, product success and failure. Like, I think that's absolutely true. And that's why you can just look historically at, you know, 10, 20, 30 year time horizons. Look at companies that have, you know, withstood the test of time. Look at your Cokes, look at your Pepsis, look at your McDonald's, look at your Microsofts, look at all these companies. You're going to see the stock doing very, very well over a period of decades. And this gets to the whole weighing machine comment from Benjamin Graham there. So, yes. And of course, I apologize for coughing every 3.5 minutes. But yeah, one of these days, hopefully, we won't be sick. But that day is not today. So Ryan says, just a comment to say thanks for the options crash course. Total game changer for my profitability. Learning about beta weighting delta and how to think about things holistically over the individual trades. Man, Ryan, I appreciate you. Thank you so much for investing in the options crash course. I mean, you're here. You're also investing in From Theory to Practice. I appreciate you so much, man. So thank you for being here and thank you for investing in the Tasty World. I mean, it's because of you that we can do what we do. So thank you so much. It really means the world to me. It means the world to all of us. And so thank you, thank you, thank you. It's awesome that it really helped you. That's so cool. And stay tuned. We do have a new crash course coming online in the next couple of weeks. I think it should be released. And so I know I keep saying that, but this shouldn't turn into like a Canada Tasty Works thing. Like, it's really going to be in the next couple of weeks, couple of months. Like, no more than 6 months. This thing will be out and you guys will be able to access it. So YT Gawker says an inverse ETF on SAS, sort of like SARC, maybe. Let's do it, man. You know, let's absolutely do it. I mean, they've got the inverse Cramer ETF, which I believe is a real thing. And so these things can happen. You know, where there's a dream and a will, there is a way. So some of you should make it happen. Band together, pool your resources, and I would absolutely go ahead and do that thing. So Brian says, did you have shawarma for lunch today? You know, I didn't. I did not. I did receive several shawarma recipes, though. But then I was like, ah, man, like, there's so many things I've got to get. I've got to get, you know, the shawarma ingredients, which I don't happen to have on hand. I also don't happen to have a shawarma, you know, maker in my den like some of my cohorts have. And so I was like, well, you know, this is not really going to be good for me. This is going to take way too much time. So I just went with the tried and true, you know, chicken and barbecue sauce, oatmeal, peanut butter. And, you know, that was pretty much our go-to for lunch. But, yeah, shawarma for lunch. One of these days, I'll have some shawarma for lunch. And if I don't, I'm still going to lead everybody to the promised land and take them for some shawarma when we get to Houston, Texas on March 25th. So March 25th, Houston, Texas, the Bad Trader Tour. I'll be there. Tom will be there. Jamal will be there. Julia will be there. Liz will be there. Jenny will be there. Man, it's going to be a ton of fun. I really, really can't wait. And so really excited about that to get to see so many of you all. So Shantu 69 says, Dr. Jim, for bigger expected IV pump events like earnings, et cetera, or even like CPI, et cetera, why would anyone sell options longer than one day out if IV will remain elevated prior to the event? Day before seems best. Your thoughts? Yeah. So a couple of thoughts. So usually when we have these IV pumps, like, we're kind of having it right now going into CPI tomorrow. And then, of course, all the earnings events that also take place with individual companies every quarter and all those things. It usually makes sense to get in at the very end of the IV pump. And so usually, I mean, you kind of alluded to this in your final comment there. But we'd like to get in like on the final moments before the event. So whether it be, you know, right on the bell before CPI. So that would be like today on the bell. So like today on the bell would be a great time to sell premium, sell implied volatility going into tomorrow's number. And then, of course, with earnings announcements and things like that, you know, we would do it on typically the day of the earnings announcement. Or if it's like a morning announcement, then we would do it the day before. And so that kind of gets into what you said. But you also said, why would anyone sell options longer than one day out if IV will remain elevated prior to the event? So, I think that what you're asking is if an event is in like a week, let's say. In fact, actually, wait a minute. I don't want to give you a hypothetical example. Let's grab a real example. So, like, for example, if I'm looking at earnings, excuse me again. If I look at Walmart, I appreciate you guys bearing with me and all of my ailments. If I'm looking at Walmart, Q21, this would be a great example. Like, if I want to play Walmart earnings, it doesn't really make a ton of sense for me to play that today. Like, it doesn't really make a ton of sense for me to go ahead and sell premium in Walmart today, knowing that implied volatility is going to remain elevated or even get more elevated heading into that earnings call, which is in 8 days. So I would much prefer to sell premium in Walmart you know, next Tuesday, right before earnings, which is going to be 2/21. And so, and not to mention, we have a 3-day weekend and all those kinds of things. And so I completely agree with you there, Shantu. You're exactly right. You're 100% on the mark there. That's why we typically don't like to trade earnings or even CPI events specifically related to the event itself until the event is about to happen. And so that would be like today for CPI or for Walmart earnings. Well, hold on a second. This one's interesting. So if you look at Walmart earnings, it's before the bell on Tuesday, February 21st. So that means that we can't trade on Monday because the markets are closed. So we'd have to put that trade on Friday afternoon. So Friday before the bell is when you would want to trade Walmart earnings if you want to trade Walmart earnings. And so that means you've got weekend risk. That means you've got 3-day weekend risk. That means you've got all these different things. But if you're just like, man, I got to be in Walmart earnings, like my life is not complete unless I have a Walmart earnings play on, then you'd have to do that on Friday afternoon before the bell. And if you feel that way, just in a general sense, you might want to seek someone to talk to about that. So HB, if options probability are accurate, why not stick to 30 delta weeklies for greater compounding? Or conversely, go out to the 30 delta for next year to lock in a solid return? It's a great question. So a couple of comments, because you kind of have two separate questions in there. And you can do that. You can do both of those things. But I'm going to give you two reasons. I'm going to give you a counterpoint to each one of your suggestions. So going into the weeklies to compound a little bit more frequently, or going out to like the leaps to lock in a solid return, you know, for that, you know, for that period of time. So number one, if I sell 30 delta weeklies, are the probabilities correct? Yes, the probabilities are correct in a world that can't possibly know exactly what's going to happen next. So yes, the probabilities are correct, but we still don't know what's going to happen next. Nobody knows what's going to happen next. And so, yes, if I sell 30 delta puts, like I should win 70% of the time, approximately, right? And I know because implied volatility is overstated and, you know, IV gets pumped up, there's a little extra juice, I'm actually going to win like 72 or 74 or something like that. Like that's all, we know all that. That's all empirically shown. But it doesn't change the fact that you're still going to have to absorb some gorilla smackage. You're going to have to absorb some huge losers along the way. That's part of the game. And so that's going to happen too. And we don't know when those are going to come. We don't know what frequency they're going to come with. We don't know any of those things. Nobody knows those things. And so when you think about that and you think about the weeklies, it's like, okay, the probabilities are correct, whether it's weekly, monthly, yearly, whatever. But we also have to make sure that you understand that they're just probabilities. They're not guarantees. They're not like, okay, you know, I'm going to lock in, you know, this return or this money or whatever. So that's the first thing I'll say, just as a general comment to the two separate kind of situations that you posed for us. If I go into the weeklies though, so one of the reasons that I personally don't like the weeklies, and I think a lot of the traders at Tasty would agree with this, is it doesn't give you the flexibility that you have in the monthlies. So when you go into a monthly option with 45 days to go or 35 days to go or 50 days to go or whatever, you just have so much flexibility to where things aren't moving super fast. Like you have an opportunity to adjust. You have an opportunity to like, you know, kind of just think as things begin to move and kind of, you know, go against you. You can kind of, you know, analyze your risk return, analyze how things have changed, and then make kind of gradual incremental decisions. That's really valuable in my opinion. When you're trading weekly options all the time, you're not really going to be able to do that. So if I'm trading weekly options and I'm trying to roll those guys over and over and over again, I'm trying to keep those guys going to compound those guys, then I'm gonna have a real hard time making adjustments because it's just going to be very, very challenging. It's going to be very challenging, not necessarily to make the adjustments, but to be able to do them where things are not moving crazily, especially on a day like tomorrow where the market's going to whip around a lot. Like, I don't know what direction it's going to go and I don't know what the number is going to be, but I can tell you one thing for sure. It's not going in a straight line. It's just not going to go in a straight line. Now, even if it goes up huge or down huge, you're going to see some back and forth. You're going to see some whipperoony take place, you know, right when the number is released. That's just very normal. That's what the market does to kind of find equilibrium. But when it comes to that happening in a weekly cycle, you just don't have all the adjustments that you would normally have in a monthly. So that's why I really don't like that. As far as, you know, going out to like a 30 delta, you know, in like an annual cycle to like lock in a return, I mean, let's just look at this really quick. This is such a good question. Let me go into, let me go to SPY. So let's say I went into SPY and, you know, let's say I go all the way out to December 15th, 2023. and I'm looking at a 30 delta. I'm looking at a 30 delta put in this cycle. 380, the 380 put in December 15th, 2023. I would be able to collect $15 on this. And so that's like what? That's like a not even a 4% return on your investment, on your money for that trade. I mean, that's not a bad return. That's a fine return. But that's what you're looking at. You're looking at a 4% return, you know, 3.75% return on this trade. Are you locking this in? I don't think so. I don't think so at all, actually, because, I mean, you're only 30 points out of the money with this 380 put in the December 15, 2023 cycle. And so, yes, 30 points in the S&Ps or in SPY is a tremendous amount of buffer. But also, I mean, we could chew through half of that in a couple of seconds after tomorrow's print if the number is not appreciated and liked by, you know, the market participants. I mean, we could be down. We could be back to 395 in the blink of an eye, right? And so, you know, I wouldn't really think of this in terms of locking in a return. I really wouldn't think of it in those terms at all. You know, instead, I would just, you know, think of it in terms of, okay, you have a longer term play that's going to maybe diversify your timelines a little bit. And it's definitely a lot longer than anything I would usually consider. And I mean, if you want to lock in a return, I mean, I wouldn't do that. I mean, this is not, you're not even getting 4%. Just go buy a UST bill. Go buy a 13-week UST bill and you get 4.5%. And then as long as the U.S. government doesn't, you know, go defunct on its debts, which, you know, is assumed to be a 100% probability. Maybe it's not. Maybe it's 50-50. I don't know. But I think it's pretty close to a risk-free instrument. Then, I mean, that's what I would do if I was looking for a 4% return. And then you have no risk, you know, again, other than, you know, the U.S. government defaulting on their debts, alien invaders taking over the U.S. government, etc. So that's what I would do right there, HP. So, and then you said it might be a dumb question. No, that was actually a great question. And I'm really glad you brought it up. And hopefully it kind of gave you a couple of things to think about there. So Harold says, would it be considered playing with fire? Ooh, I like this question. The third time around by placing the same strike Nike position, different expiration. Oh, yeah, man. So Harold's talking about the put diagonals that he has given us that have been quite profitable the first two go rounds. I'm not going to mess with that. I'm going to let you mess with that. That does seem like you might be trying to, you know, tempt fate a little bit too much, but it could certainly, you know, where is Nike at right now? We're going to NKE 125. Yeah, man, you might suck me in one more time. Ah, they got earnings. So April, March, I don't know, man. Let's just give it just a real quick gander. If I buy a 130 in April, this is basically the same trade we've been doing. And then I sell a 120 in March. Yeah, it's a lot more expensive now. And so that's probably because of earnings kind of being sandwiched between the two cycles there. And that sandwich like an actual sandwich, not sandwich like a hot dog, as we talked about this morning on the skinny and options abstract applications. And so 130, 120. Yeah, I'm going to pass on this one because that is a little costly. It's still lower than our threshold. I mean, we like to be underneath 75%, which this is underneath 75%. But I am going to pass on this one, at least in that current setup. And so let's see. So Miko says, hey, Dr. Jim, thanks for the awesome show. Hey, thank you for being here, man. I appreciate you even struggling through. For those of you that are still watching, struggling through the cough, struggling through the, you know, the Luther Vandross voice, which that might be an uptick, actually. I'm not sure. But struggling through all these things, I appreciate you guys, man, very much. And so Charles says, aliens are attracted to lithium ion waste deposits. Apparently so, right? I mean, apparently, whatever that means. I mean, I don't really know what that means. But yeah, I mean, if they are, then I guess they found their place, I guess. HP says, UFO invasion, good for QQQ, the innovation index. That's right. QQQ is going to find a way to make some money on these alien invaders. I can assure you of that. And so I'm quite confident that Elon Musk is going to recruit some of them to be on the first crew up to Mars. Because just from a diversity standpoint, just to get different skill sets and get different, you know, backgrounds and get different life experiences, I think that that would be a really, really positive thing. And so AJ Bucky says, Jim, when you roll up a strangle to add the money to move the untested side, what is your new escape price to close it? Yeah. So AJ Bucky's basically saying, I've got a strangle on. I've been tested to one side, and I'll turn it into a straddle. Yeah. So what is your new escape price to close it? So I've done a couple of segments on this. So number one, if you go to the YouTube channel, which you're already there because you're asking questions on the YouTube channel. So this might be the easiest escape route for you to find my answer to the escape route. I did a crash course, completed a crash course a few months ago now, 4 or 5 months ago now, on rolling. I think it was the most recent crash course that is on the network. I did a crash course on rolling, talked about how to adjust your profit targets after you've rolled a position. And so I would check that out because it's going to give you more resources than I can muster up right here in the waning minutes of the show and in the waning volume that's left in my voice. And so I would check that out. That's going to give you a lot of thoughts and insights into what you're asking. But a lot of it depends on, how are you viewing the position now? Are you viewing the position more defensively or are you viewing the position more offensively? And most of the time, after you've rolled a position, you're going to naturally be viewing the position defensively. So if I'm viewing the position defensively, I'm probably going to scale down my profit target. So when it was 50% of original credit collected, it may come down now to, 50% of total credit, well, not total credits collected. It may come down to, 25% of original credit collected or even a scratch on the position. It depends on a lot of things like how dire the situation is, what your directional bias is, overall risk in the position. And again, whether or not you view it offensively or defensively, I think is a really, really important thing. So hopefully that helps you a little bit, AJ, but check out the rolling crash course. I think it will help you even more so than what I can muster right now. So let's see. Miko says, how should I treat index IVs, SPY, the Qs, IWM, compared to individual stock IV? Stocks are obviously more volatile. Should I be happy with a lower IV reading on the index ETFs? Well, that's a great question, and you're correct. The index IVs are usually going to be lower because they don't have the unsystematic risk that individual stocks have. And this is going to be kind of the idiosyncratic, the company-level risk. Like Tesla has Elon Musk risk, right? NASDAQ still has Elon Musk risk, but it's a little bit different. It can be spread across, your Spotify's and your Snowflake's and your whoever else's that don't necessarily, involve Elon Musk, although his hand is in a lot of cookie jars these days. So it might be difficult to find stocks that aren't necessarily impacted by him. But generally speaking, index IVs are going to be lower than individual stock IVs. And so should you be happy that they're lower? Well, it depends on how you define happy. I mean, it's really just a fact of trading. It's just a fact of the markets. And so it's definitely something you want to be aware of and definitely something that you want to take note of. But the real question is, should you adjust your trading strategy because the IVs are expected to be lower in the individual or in the indexes relative to the individual stocks? I think possibly. Like, for example, if I go to SPY, here, you can see the IV rank is 19.7. So maybe my threshold for IV ranks on indexes is only like, if it's like 25 or 30, that's pretty good. Like 25 or 30, maybe that's all I need to get me interested in, putting on a position, a short premium position in this index. Whereas if I go to an individual stock, maybe now I need at least 40 or 50 or something like that. And I'm just throwing numbers out there in terms of things that you can consider, not necessarily what you should just plug right in and go with it. But just, that would be a reasonable way to approach this difference between indexes and individual stocks and their implied volatility differentials. And so, so hopefully that helps a little bit. Chris, thoughts on selling one-day strangles in XSP? Yes, I hate it. I hate it. So zero DTEs and one-day strangles and one-day whatevers. I really, really, really do not like these trades. The only time that I might consider doing things that are like zero DTE or like one DTE or whatever is when I already have a current position on. And I want to cover that position a little bit, like meaning I have some shares or I have a futures contract or whatever, and I want to turn it into a covered call or a covered put. But I don't really want to do that for like 45 days to go. I kind of just want to, cover some risk for the next day or the rest of that trading day or whatever. And so in that context, I think maybe it can have some merit, but I really don't like just straight up unlimited risk. Naked options, things like that, which is 0 1 day to go, or even defined risk. I actually like that even less for 0 1 days to go. I just feel like you're leaving yourself you're losing out on a lot of flexibility that you could otherwise have with the markets. Market's selling off a little bit here as we wind down the show. Let me try to get to one more question. And normally I would try to get to some questions on my Twitter feed afterwards, but I don't know that I will. Just because of the old sickness thing here. And so let's see, Mr. Rich Reich, Swarmer Maker. Oh yeah, you found him, baby. I'm the Swarmer Maker. Like, you thought it was Bob Nasanov, but it's not. And so Mr. Pillow says, so hyped for Houston, man. I'm hyped too. I can't wait. It's going to be fun. I'm working on some brand new B-minus humor for you guys. It's going to be a good time. Grumpy Mike says, wait, chicken, oatmeal, peanut butter, and barbecue sauce together? No, not together. But that's not a bad idea. I like the innovation right there. And so one final question. Here we go. It's a perfect question. Stanley, man, says, Jim, how were the students on Friday? So Friday I was fine. Friday I was not sick. It was the one day in the last, 6 weeks where I was actually feeling well. And so that was good. It was amazing, man. I'm going back this Friday to kind of show them how we use like normal distribution and show them the platform a little bit. And it's going to be a ton of fun, but they were great, man. They were great. I did four classes. They were super engaged. I was actually surprised at how engaged they were because I didn't really know what to expect. I mean, I've never really done a presentation or talked to high school kids. I'm used to college age kids, and they can be, that can be like pulling teeth a lot of the time. So I'm like, all right, take it down a couple levels, fast forward, it's been 8 years since I've been in the classroom. I'm like, all right, man. So I don't really know what to expect, but they were super engaged. They were very much into what we were talking about, which was really cool because it was all brand new to them. A lot of it was brand new to them. And so it was amazing. I think our future is bright. If the classes that I spoke to at St. Pete High School are any indication, then I feel really good about where we are headed as a country and as a global financial society. But guys, that's it, man. I'm all out of time. Thank you guys for being here. I really appreciate you guys so much. Don't forget, guys, you can always email me. I have a new email now. It's jschultz@tastylive.com. So jschultz@tastylive.com. Shoot me an email with all the migration and stuff. I'm still getting caught up, so I'm a little bit behind, but I will get to it as soon as I possibly can. If you guys want to connect on Twitter, I'm at jschultzf3. I would love to connect with you on there as well. But stay tuned. We do have Jamal coming up next for Engineering the Trade. In the meantime, guys, trade them small, trade them heavy, and good luck tomorrow morning. We'll see you guys tomorrow. J'étais, oui, j'étais un démon.